Greetings from Middle Earth, everybody. As Bilbo Baggins would say, I don't know half of you half as well as I should like, and I like less than half of you half as well as you deserve. Now, there's so many double negatives in there, you can't work out if that's a compliment or not. But the truth is, unlike Bilbo talking to his fellow hobbits, I actually love talking to you. And I missed you guys, and we tried to FaceTime. That was a beautiful disaster last week. I had no clue what was going on. So I'm glad I'm back with you in person. I try to be super faithful to be here every Monday night, but there was a rare opportunity that I'm going to tell you a little bit about it in New Zealand that I want to talk about. In Job 38:7, it says, the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. And the context is God is speaking to Job about creation, laying the foundations of the earth, building Leviathan and Behemoth and the stars. And he says, where were you at the foundation, the beginning of all things? He says, when the angels were singing together and shouting for joy. The context behind the text is that the angels were actually singing when, according to Psalms, God breathed stars into existence. Now, J.R.R. Tolkien, the author of The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, ran with that. One of my favorite books he ever wrote called The Silmarillion. In The Silmarillion, he talks about how the Eldar, which are these ancient elves, sang the world into existence, and Morgoth, who was the master of Sauron, began singing discordant notes into the tune and thus warped creation. And that's why there's death and evil and malnutrition and distortion. So he talks about evil as being a distortion of the original melody of good that was sang into existence by the Eldar. And he was taking that from the words of Job here, Job 38:7, that God was speaking to the suffering servant. Now, what's so cool about that is I think that's a very good paradigm for evil. I really like that explanation as to why there's bad in the world, because the enemy is not like, you know, this sunburned fawn twirling his Hitler Third Reich mustache, you know, zapping people with his Zeus trident, wearing really tight tights that would make Mick Jagger, you know, blush. No, we're talking about a real force of evil in the world that is distorting, twisting the good that God sang into existence with his angels at creation. And so it really did feel like in New Zealand, where they filmed The Lord of the Rings, as we were kind of touring around there, it really did feel like the Eldar were singing the world into existence. Like, we climbed up treetops like 100 feet into the air with these harnesses, and felt like when you turned your backs on the trees, the Ents might whisper and walk. It was very magical. I could have been projecting because I love Lord of the Rings and I've read it multiple times. But so every day we did a bunch of events and we spread hope to New Zealand. We started off by going to Shine TV, did a national TV and radio interview. Again, that TV show interview went to all the screens in the country. So we got to spread hope through TV. Then we did events and outreaches, and each day just packing the day with ways to speak to people about hope. God opened up a really cool door. We got to go, and we'll be showing you a video of it in a couple weeks, but we got to go to the biggest Christian school in the nation. So there were more than 1,000 kids there, Kiwis there, just in the high school, and we were like speaking hope to them. And Rob Salvato, the guy who put it on, they said that it was the best assembly they'd ever had, because most of the kids that go there are not churched. So it's a Christian school, but they're not necessarily Christians. So it was cool to get to go in there, spread hope. And also we had, he's one of my new closest friends, a guy named, and I just met him through this trip, his name's Cody Flom. You might have seen him on YouTube, but basically Cody Flom is the fifth best scooter rider in the world. Now, the reason why that's crazy is because I'm like, wait, I'm going with a scooter rider, like scootering, really? What's insane is we did a bunch of outreaches at skate parks in New Zealand. Scooter riding is bigger than skating. So right now, skating's very much having a resurgence. It's very much in vogue in California. But in New Zealand, people scooter more than they skate. So it was crazy. I was actually there filming it with my iPhone. Cody, during this outreach, went off a jump at the skate park. He did a backflip 180 triple tail whip. It was insane. And he landed, and at the last minute, he fell and broke his wing. Like, he broke his thumb. So it was the first event we did, and the rest of the time he had to be there in a cast. So he, with his cast, starts doing tricks and tail whips and going off jumps. I'm like, this guy's a boss. After we went to the hospital and kids are like recognizing him on the street, they're like, sign my scooter. And like one kid drove from 3 hours with a Cody Flom scooter and like, sign my scooter. And he's like, sign my cast. And it was actually a really, really cool thing that God did. And he was able to share his testimony and story as well. But then my favorite part was, along with all this speaking and outreaches, we also got to explore a little bit on the off time at night. And we went up to, it was one of the most magical moments probably of my adulthood, because we went up a staircase of waterfalls. There was one waterfall cascading down into another waterfall, cascading down into another waterfall. You see why Peter Jackson wanted to film here for Middle Earth. It felt like Rivendell. And so we hiked up like where nobody would go up the side of the mountain, and we sat under the starlight. The stars were scintillating like sapphires against the inky velvet of interstellar space. There's stars up ahead. You can see them so clearly. They're glistening in the pool below as three waterfalls. There's this staircase happening. And watch this. We started seeing all these Christmas lights in the trees around us, but nobody was there. We're like, why are there Christmas lights in the trees around us? And we were trying to figure out what they were. Then we discovered they were glowworms. So there were glowworms everywhere. It was one of the most beautiful sights of my life. Cody's like, this is the best moment of my life. I'm like, I'm getting my imagination baptized like C.S. Lewis after reading George MacDonald's Fantasties. Like, this is insane. They looked like the monsters in cartoons that are looking out from the trees with strange fantastical eyes, these magical beasts, like all these glowworms in the forest around us. Truly, truly magical. And then we went to the Shire. We got to actually visit Hobbiton and go to Bag End and visit Bilbo's house and hang out in hobbit holes and stuff, which was really great. But you know what the most lasting thing that happened to me on that trip? The most lasting thing that happened to me on that trip is the windshield wiper. You say, what do you mean? You know how you have to drive on the left side of the road there? It's so confusing because of the roundabouts. They have all kinds of roundabouts and you have to stay on the left lane. So I was constantly swerving into the wrong lane. And what happened is every time I'd hit the blinker, I was hitting the windshield because I just have this Pavlovian dog reflex, like just to hit, you know, right here. Well, in New Zealand, that's the windshield wiper. So my friends endlessly trolled me about how I couldn't turn on the blinker. You know when you're at a driver's test, driver's ed, and the guy's sitting in the seat next to you and you hit the windshield and you're like, okay, I'm not passing. So I kept hitting the windshield. So I come back here and every time I'm trying to turn, this was the first time I drove since I got back just now because I flew in late last night. Or sometime, I don't even remember. But basically, every time I like hit the blinker, it's the windshield. I'm like, wait, is this the windshield or the blinker? And it's continuously confusing. And then yesterday, this is a cool story. One more thing I want to share with you. We ended the tour by going to San Diego, and I got to share with 1,000 people yesterday in San Diego a message of hope. And this one guy, I won't say his name, my friend Brighton brought him to service. The night before, he came into my hotel room, and he's like just cussing up a storm. He's like, let's go clubbing. Let's go get drunk. Let's go get hammered. Let's go. He didn't know what I did for a living. He's like, let's just go to all these parties, right? So the next day, he comes to church and he sees me get up there to speak. And he's like, because he couldn't picture me speaking. So he's like, what's happening? So in most churches, it's actually kind of funny. The ushers come forward and they say, the pastor says, whoever doesn't have a Bible, raise your hand and the ushers will pass out a Bible. That's what a lot of churches do. They do that there. So this guy, he raises his hand to get a Bible, and he has this Bible, right? By the end of the service, this was so cool. He literally stole the Bible. I'm like, if there's justification for stealing, steal a Bible. But he just smuggled. He was a Bible smuggler, not into North Korea like Kim Jong-un and Dennis Rodman getting ticked. We're talking about like smuggling the Bible out of the church. And it's just cool, like, I don't know, guys, I'm getting this sense that God is up to something, that Aslan is on the move, if you'll suffer the mixed metaphor, that God is really doing something to create a generation of hope in us, and it's really fun. So I wanted to give you a quick update about that, and let's continue our Journey of Hope messages, Matthew 26, starting in verse 47. May we wander among the wonders. May we not lose hope for our generation. We're seeing God on the move. We're seeing great things happening. And I believe a genuine, genuine move of hope. We actually, by the way, I forgot to tell you, where we did ministry is in the number one suicide area of New Zealand. So really, really cool stuff to give them hope. So Matthew 26, verse 47. Let's take a look at this. This is Jesus beginning the Passion of the Christ. And in verse 47, Matthew 26, tells us this. And while Jesus, he was still speaking, behold, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now his betrayer had given them a sign saying, whomever I kiss, he is the one, seize him. Immediately he went up to Jesus and said, greetings, Rabbi, and kissed him. But Jesus said to him, friend, why have you come? Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. And suddenly one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. But Jesus said to him, put your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels? How then could the scriptures be fulfilled that it must happen thus? In that hour, Jesus said to the multitudes, have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to take me? I sat daily with you teaching in the temple and you did not seize me. But all this was done that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled. Then all the disciples forsook him and fled. Great friends. So Jesus is entering what's called the passion of the Christ. The Greek word is passion. It means suffering. And when Jesus is entering into his passion, this is all happening in the city of Jerusalem. Now, there were only two miracles that Jesus ever did before the crucifixion and resurrection in Garden of Gethsemane. The two miracles he did was he healed a blind man at the pool of Siloam, and he healed a paralyzed man at the pool of Bethesda. A lame man and a blind man were the two people he healed. Interesting, because the Bible calls Jesus the Son of David. Everyone say Son of David. Now, David was the one who founded the city of Jerusalem, and the only two miracles Jesus does before the garden, crucifixion, resurrection, the only two miracles he does in Jerusalem are healing the lame and the blind. And he's called the Son of David. David was the king who founded Jerusalem. Before it was called Jerusalem, Jerusalem used to be called Jebus. That's why there's a Star of David on the flag. He's the one who founded the city. And when he was attacking Jerusalem to conquer it, the Jebusites who were inhabiting the city, they taunted David and said, even the lame and the blind could stop you. That was ancient trash talk. Even the lame and the blind could stop you. And it said, nevertheless, David overtook it. So the lame and the blind could stop you, said the Jebusites, and David overcame their taunts and conquered the city militarily, even though they said, the lame and the blind could stop you. You have no chance. Interesting, because what were the two miracles the Son of David did in the city of Jerusalem? Healing the lame and the blind. What he was saying is David took care of the military needs of the city. Even the lame and blind could stop you. He conquered it. But I, the Son of David, take care of the spiritual and physical needs of the city of Jerusalem. Even the lame and the blind cannot stop me from healing them. Come on. I do believe veritable bars have been dropped. Okay. Notice they call him, when he's here being arrested, Judas betraying him, Judas says, Rabbi, 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 Rabboni. Did you know that this is one of the reasons some scholarship actually suggests that Jesus was a Pharisee? And if Jesus was a Pharisee, that means he blew up the system from within, because his arch nemesis were the Pharisees. And so Judas calls him Rabbi. Again, Jesus was at the temple teaching like a rabbi, walking with the Pharisees, teaching day in, day out. He's like, why didn't you arrest me then? Now you're coming at me with swords, clubs, and spears, which is just so bad apple. Like, he's coming into Jerusalem as a rabbi, blowing up the system from within, telling the rabbis and Pharisees that they were whitewashed tombs, perhaps as one of them after being a construction worker. Jesus may well have been a Pharisee, some scholarship suggests. But then as he's there in the garden, Judas says, Rabbi, perhaps Jesus was a Pharisee, kisses him to identify who Jesus was. The interesting thing about that is, have you ever seen a boxing match where, like, Floyd Mayweather KOs his opponent and the commentator says Mayweather just planted the kiss of death on his opponent? Do you know where the boxing phrase kiss of death comes from? It comes from this passage. It comes from Matthew. When Judas planted the kiss of death on Jesus, that's where that phrase comes from. Notice, what does Jesus call Judas in this story? Jesus said to him, friend, why have you come? This is the last thing Jesus ever said to Judas. Friend, why have you come? Friend, why have you come? Do what you have come to do and do it swiftly. The last thing Jesus ever calls Judas is friend. Let's get practical tonight. Maybe you're here and you're feeling like you could never be like Abraham, a friend of God. Jesus said to his disciples, I no longer call you servants. I call you friends. But you say, I could never be called a friend of God. The New Testament authors tell us that Judas was inhabited by Satan. And if Jesus could call him friend, then that shows we have a very, very gracious Jesus in this passage. He says, friend, 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 friend. It's amazing. Jesus didn't just call him friend, but he acted like his friend. Did you know when Jesus was washing the feet of his disciples right before this story, who was he washing the feet of? Peter, James, John, Thomas, Bartholomew, Jude, and Judas, and all the other disciples. So he's washing his feet. And not only that, but he shares bread with Judas. He actually takes from the same loaf and dips it in the same sauce, the same sop that Judas dips his bread into. Now, the reason that's interesting is because Jesus got in trouble for the company he kept when he was eating. Because back then, eating was a communal act. When the psalmist said in Psalm 23, you have prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. What he was saying is, you'll provide me with community. You'll provide me with friends. You'll provide me with fellowship. Because eating back then, you didn't do through a drive-through by yourself. You did it as a community. So when Jesus was eating with tax collectors and sinners, he was standing in solidarity with them. It was actually a political act of solidarity, and they were scientifically way ahead of their time, because when you're talking about anatomy, the same loaf of bread, the quantum particles that go into that loaf of bread, the same quantum information that goes into you goes into me. We're sharing from the same loaf. You are what you eat. The same atoms that go into Judas were going into Jesus. He was, in essence, offering oneship with Judas, standing in political solidarity with Judas. That's why Jesus got in trouble for eating, not just hanging out with, but eating with tax collectors and sinners, because he's saying therein the Pharisees are out, if anything. Although he would eat with Pharisees too, because he's so gracious. But the interesting thing about this is, in this story, he washes Judas's feet. Jesus stands in solidarity with Judas by eating bread and dipping from the same sauce, even though he knew he was going to get betrayed and that Judas was driven by the powers of darkness and the prince of evil. But he also calls him friend. Look at this passage. He calls him friend. Now, an unnamed disciple in this passage then unsheaths his sword as the Jewish lynch mob comes to apprehend the fugitive Jesus. And the unnamed disciple, he pulls out his sword and he chops off Malchus's ear, who is the servant of the high priest that came to arrest Jesus. Notice religion is arresting Jesus. Religion is trying to kill Jesus. But what I find so fascinating about this is this, watch. When they come to arrest Jesus and Peter takes out his sword, we know it's Peter from another gospel. The unnamed disciple is actually Peter, the caffeinated disciple. I relate to him. But Peter chops off Malchus's ear to free Jesus from the arrest led by Judas the traitor. And watch this. I love what Jesus says. He says, Peter, put away your sword. I got this. I could say one prayer and summon 12 legions of angels to wipe out this whole lynch mob. How many angels is that? Well, if you do the math, one angel in Isaiah killed, in the story, 185,000 Assyrians in one night. Okay, how much is a legion? Well, a legion was a first century Roman military unit that consisted of 6,000 troops. So if you multiply 6,000 times 12, Jesus said I could call down 12 legions, 6,000 troop units of angels, you get 72,000. You like numbers. 72,000. If you get 72,000 angels and then multiply that by 185,000, that's how many a single angel could kill, and we're lowballing it, what you get is this number. If you take a census of the Earth's population in the year 1 AD, there were 300 million people on Earth at the time this story happened. 300 million people on Earth. Which means Jesus was saying, if you take into account mathematically the 300 million people on Earth taking a census year 1 AD, you multiply 185,000 times 12 times 6,000, what Jesus was saying is, I could wipe out 13.32 billion people with one prayer. And if you take all that into account, what he was saying is, I could wipe out the entire Earth's population mathematically 44.4 times over with a single prayer. I got this. He's powerful. Like when you picture Jesus gentle and mild, remember, he's very powerful. Another story tells us that when they came to arrest Jesus, they said, who is Jesus of Nazareth? It's not like the guy with the Miss America pageant sash. with like the halo. He was a normal looking Jewish guy. Like, which one's Jesus of Nazareth? Judas has to kiss him, and Jesus says, laying down his life of his own volition, as he said in John 10, I lay down my life for my sheep. No one takes it from me. I give it willingly. They say, who is Jesus of Nazareth? He says, I am. Does that ring any psychic cherries or biblical bells for you? What happened in Exodus? What did the burning bush that liked to do existentialist poetry, cogito ergo sum, I doubt, therefore I think, therefore I am, would make Rene Descartes proud. What did the bush say in the book of Exodus? I am that I am. Jesus quotes the bush, I am. The minute he says those two words, I am, I love this story. It says, all the soldiers fell down backwards. It's like, who's Jesus? I am. Boom, just knocks him down. His word was so powerful that one time, not only could he knock people down just by his word, but one time some soldiers came to arrest Jesus and they couldn't apprehend the fugitive. So they came back to their CO, their superior commanding officer, and they said, we couldn't arrest Jesus of Nazareth. And this commanding officer said, why? And the soldier said, because no man ever spake like this man. In other words, he was a really smooth talker. What, did he have an AK-47? No, he had a John 3:16. Grah. Game over. Hashtag not messing around. Low-key world domination. I am. Boom. They all fall down backwards. We're going to arrest you. I'll just talk and you'll run away scampering in fear. Amazing. His word's so powerful. But not only that, not only his prayer could have wiped them out, not only his word could have knocked them over, but even one of his disciples, not just Peter, but Simon, we're told was a zealot. Who were zealots? Well, zealots, they were political insurgents and revolutionaries. In fact, we just went to Israel, and this was confirmed when we were following the tour guide. I had read about it before. But in ancient Israel, there were these caves, you can see them, where these Sicarii dagger bearers would hide in caves with cloaks, and they had their sword in cloaks. Have you ever heard the phrase cloak and dagger? So they would have their dagger in their cloak, and then they would sneak into the marketplace and stab Roman citizens and stab Roman sympathizers, put their cloak in their garment, then run away. And they teamed up with the zealots. The zealots and the Sicarii dagger bearers wanted to kill the Romans. Jesus had a disciple named Simon the Zealot, but he also had a disciple named Matthew the tax collector, and tax collectors worked for Rome. Do you see why they argued a lot? Matthew's working for Rome, Simon's killing Romans. They have to get to work together because the Christ who unites us is greater than the difficulties that divide us. Can I get an amen? So Jesus could have used his political power, thrown his political weight around, his political gravitas, his powerful prayers, his powerful word. But in light of all of that, he lays down his life. Oh, he has strength. He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And we know that the Father is so powerful that Isaiah says he can lift islands as though they were a very little thing. The nations are as a drop in the bucket. I just learned this. This is cool. Have you ever heard the phrase, oh, that's not a drop in the bucket? Like, oh, sorry, I pulled $5 out. You know, you might say to your mom, I'm sorry, I pulled $5 out of the ATM. She says, oh, that's just a drop in the bucket. We're good. The phrase drop in a bucket actually comes from the Bible, from the book of Isaiah. When God says, I lift islands as though they were a little thing, all the nations are but a drop in the bucket. God's like, I'm really powerful. My dad can curl iron, but God can curl islands. He's powerful. He could wipe out everyone, and yet, here's where I'm going, and I'm beginning our descent. Jesus lays down his life, lays down his power, and says, I love you so much. Don't think I just got crucified as revolutionary because I got caught on the inescapable horns of a dilemma. No, I lay down my life willingly. Greater love has no man than this, than that he lays down his life for his friends. And Romans 5 says that Jesus would even die for his enemies. He surpassed his own definition of the greatest love. Ephesians said that you would know the height, width, breadth, length, and depth of the love of God, which passes knowledge. That's how much he loves you. I'm gonna close with a little game. It's called Save or Kill. I've done it before, but this is a whole new one. I did it in New Zealand. I'm gonna do it with you. To illustrate my point, we're gonna play a quick game of Save or Kill. By round of applause only, whatever you save, you have to kill the opposite thing. Whatever you kill, you have to save the other thing. By round of applause only, I'm not gonna take raised hands into account. So I want you to be a little rowdy. By round of applause, save or kill. Number one, Riverdale, because the actor Archie from the comics, comes from New Zealand. Riverdale or Stranger Things. I feel like this music has kind of a Stranger Things vibe. It's sick. Okay, so you have to save or kill. What would you save? What would you kill? By round of applause, how many of you would save Riverdale? How many of you would save Stranger Things? Okay, Stranger Things wins. Okay, let's do this. With all the controversy politically, with concussions and kneeling and all that, what about NFL or rugby? Okay, rugby's very big there. Actually, one of the speakers at the events, he was a professional rugby player for the All Blacks. What would you choose, rugby or the NFL? How many of you would save rugby? I'm surprised. How many of you would save the NFL? Okay, I feel like some of you are not voting, but the NFL wins. Okay, two more, you have to choose. In light of Middle Earth, Eric Orn. Or, you're just automatically, yes, he's a beast. Aragorn or Legolas. Remember when the movies came out, all the girls liked both of them and you had to choose? There's like Gale or Peeta. Okay, so Aragorn or Legolas. How many of you would save Legolas? Okay. How many of you would save Aragorn? Okay, Aragorn wins. One more. I'm actually curious about this. This is totally random. Snapchat or Instagram? What would you save? What would you kill? How many of you would save Snapchat? Okay, okay. How many of you would save Insta? Okay, Instagram wins. How many? Great minds think alike. Great minds think alike. It runs in the blood. It runs in the blood. You and Dad said it at the same time. Oh, goodness. Oh, he loves you so much. My friend Sean, he posted something the other day on Instagram, and he said, this is religion. I messed up. Don't tell Dad. That's religion. Relationship says, I messed up. I better call Dad. God loves you so much that in the save or kill decision, the Father would image himself in Jesus, and Jesus would say, save them, kill me. I could use politics, I could use prayer, I could use my powerful preaching, but I'm going to lay that all down because I'm going to say the Father loves you. In the save or kill decision, Jesus said, save them, kill me. I give my life as a ransom for many. That's how much he loves you. Religion is, I messed up, I better not tell Dad. Relationship is, I messed up, I better call Dad. Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen my Father. He loves you. He loves you. That's all I want to tell you tonight. He loves you. He calls you friend. He washes your feet. He serves you. He stands in solidarity with you. And because of that, you can weather any storm. I went long tonight. I'm at 27 minutes, so I got to close in literally 80 seconds. I have a little fun short film that my friend Cam made. I want to play this for you really quick. With God's love and God's power, there is no storm that you go through. There is no storm that you go through that you cannot power through, because God's power and love is beside you. It's on your side as imaged in the life of Jesus. This is a 25-second video. It's really cool. Let's play it real fast and then I'll make a closing remark. In my womb, I'll find me. Tell you tonight that with the love of God, you can power through any storm, the storm of your sin, the storm of your shame, the storm of your sickness, the storm of your sadness, the storm of your sorrow. You can sleep in the storm. You can stomp on the storm. You can sternly rebuke the storm because you have a Savior who loves you. He loves you. He loves you so much. Can I get an amen? This is big. This is big.